So yesterday we discussed 15th question probability. Anybody still have any doubt regarding that?
No, sir.
No. Okay. So let us say 16th one. Sixteenth one. What they said is a function is there with 0 to 1, 0 to 1 is a domain and also codomain. But the main point is the equation. They gave mod f of x minus f of y is equal to mod x minus y for all x comma y which belongs to domain. Okay. So when you actually divide, you'll get mod f of x minus f of y by x minus y is equal to 1, which means f of x minus f of y by x minus y will be plus or minus 1. What is this f of x minus f of y by x minus y? Is that you take any two points, this is a slope on the curve, you take any two points as x comma f of x and y comma f of y. Okay, when you join them, that slope should be 1 or minus 1. Okay, so now it will not be a curve, it should be a line, because if it is a curve, this slope is different, this slope is different, this slope is different. Okay, but here it says you take any two points, you join, slope has to be 1 or minus 1. One may say, why not I will take partly 1, partly minus 1. Here you take any two points, slope is 1. Here you take, that is also not acceptable. Why? If you take one point here, one point here, that slope also should be 1 or minus 1, no? Right? So basically what happens is, based on this, once you take one point, in the, let us say one point is satisfying the function. Through that you draw a line with slope 1. Every other point should be on this line only, nowhere else. Or through this you draw a line with slope minus 1. Every other point should be on this line only. Okay. Either slope should be 1 or minus 1. So that's what it says. You have to recognize. So now, but if we have to take this particular domain, this particular codomain, did they say anything? Bijection may not be required, but I just want to see what other thing, is it a continuous function, what is it? The number of functions they set, but for all x and y. Okay. So between 0 to 1, everything should have image. Okay. So take 0 and 1. This is your domain. This is your codomain. So between this, I should be able to draw a line with slope 1 or slope minus 1, where I should cover this full domain, okay? And accordingly this. So there are only two such possibilities. When I start here, it will be this line. When I start here, it will be this line. I can take any other parallel line, but then it will not cover the domain properly. For example, we take 0 and 1, take a line with slope 1 like this. It may satisfy f of x minus f of y by x minus y equal to 1. But the problem is, between 0 to this number, you cannot have image, because at all these points, the y value is negative, whereas here y value is positive. Okay. So if you want to cover everything between 0 to 1, you have only two options. One is this and one is this. Okay. Otherwise, something or other will not have images, because if slope is 1, when the domain covers 1 unit, the range also will cover 1 unit. And this is exactly 1 unit. If here they would have given 0 comma 2, there would have been many options. For example, that's the only codomain I changed to 0 comma 2. Then this is 0 comma 1, 0 comma 2 is here. And they did not say it should be bijection or something like that. So somebody can take a line like this or anything parallel to that. They can take any one of these lines, still you reach here. So there'll be infinite such functions. Similarly, slope minus 1, somebody can take this one or this. Okay. There will be so many options. But here, our width is 1 and height is also exactly 1 unit. So they have, don't have much options, either this or this. If somebody wants those functions also, we can tell. This is a line with 45 degrees and passing to origin. So it is y equal to x or f of x equal to x. If it is this line, it is x plus y equal to 1. So we will get f of x is equal to 1 minus x. Basically, at 0, image is 0. At 1, image is 1. Or vice versa, at 0, image is 1. At 1, it is 0. These are the only two functions which can satisfy this data and with this particular domain and the codomain. Need not be range, codomain. Is it all right, 16?
Yes.
Yes, sir. Okay.
Right. So exactly two functions are there. This Monday we'll have a little longer class because anyway for the other campus it is maths doubt only. So I can take from 3:30, 3:25 only till 4:25 or something like that. And after that I'll clarify that. Okay, so what is this 17th question? The probability. Suppose A is a 3x3 matrix, every integer consisting of integer entries and that are chosen at random from the set minus 1000 to 1000. So total 2001 integers are there. Each element can be any one of them. What is the probability that A square is minus I or A is a diagonal matrix? Okay. If they are given A square equal I, it is a very complicated question because difficult to find a matrix. That all possible matrices where A square can be I may be, may not be difficult. But A square equal to minus I is very easy because it is not possible. Not only with this entries, any other real entries, it is not possible. A square equal to minus I. When you apply det, det of A square equal to det of minus I. Det of A square is the determinant of A whole square. Delta of minus I is minus 1 because it is 3x3. This is 2x2, it would have been plus 1. But 3x3, it is minus 1. Because delta of minus I, minus 1, 0, 0, 0, minus 1, 0, 0, 0, minus 1. Determinant is product of these diagonal elements, which is minus 1. How can a square of something be negative for real entry? It's not possible. So we will not have any, no such matrix. No such matrix with real entries. All right. Okay, so now we are left with the diagonal matrix. So that is a very simple question now. Because I have total 2001 elements are there from minus 1000 to 1000. First of all, how many 3x3 matrices are there with the elements chosen from this? This can be filled with 2001 choices. This also 2001 choices. This also 2001. This also, this also, this also, this also, this also, this also. So total number of elements in the sample space will be 2001 whole power 9. Every element has 2001 choices. Among that, we want it to be diagonal matrix. For a matrix to be diagonal matrix, this must be 0. 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 All have one choice. But these three elements, each has 2001 choices. Because in diagonal matrix, this can be anything, including 0. Okay? Including 1. Any, they can be equal distance. So this has 2001 choices. This has... So only three elements. So this are total number of matrices, but total number of diagonal matrices are only 2001 whole cube into 1 power 6. All these have one choice each, but these three have 2001 choices. Okay, so randomly when a matrix is selected among all possible matrices that are made with this, what is the probability that it will be a diagonal matrix is this, which is finally 1 by 2001 power 6. Any doubt about this? Up to here?
No.
No. Now, the answer is not exact to this. They're asking this is greater than something, less than something. So this probability, which is 1 by 2001 power 6, they want us to compare with 1 by 10 power 18 or 5 power 4 by 10 power 18. So they want a 10 power 18, but we have power 6. If at all you want to compare, that also I want to convert into power 6 form. Okay. So if I take 1 by 10 power 18, I want to write power 6, I have to write 1 by 10 cube whole power 6, which is 1 by 1000 power 6. Okay, so now if you see, obviously compared to this, this denominator is smaller, so this whole thing is greater. So I can say this is definitely, this is bigger. So less than 1 by 1000 power 6. 2001 is replaced with 1000, denominator decrease, the total increase. That's why this is bigger, this is smaller, which is equal to 1 by 10 power 18. So this expression is less than 1 by 10 power 18. What is speak of 5 cube or 5 power 4? So option A itself is correct. So option B is not correct. Option C and D doesn't have chance because it is less than 1 by 10 power 18, but they want more than 25 by 10 power 18, 125 by 10 power 18, 625 by 10 power 18, not possible. Yeah, so this question looks like very big, but if you see carefully, it's quite easy. Is it all right, 17?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay, coming to this 18th question. Before discussing 18, I want to discuss something and then come back. Normally, if you take x1 plus x2 plus x3, so on up to xn, whole square is greater than or equal to n times x1 square plus x2 square, so on up to xn square. Okay. How to prove this? There are different methods. Yes, somebody want to say something?
With arithmetic means.
Yeah. One method is you can use Jensen inequality where you take y equal to x square figure. And I'll tell with the example for three things, you can generalize for n things. If you take any three things, take this as x1 comma x1 square, this as x2 comma x2 square, this is x3 comma x3 square. The centroid will be, the coordinates of the centroid are x1 plus x2 plus x3 by 3, x1 square plus x2 square plus x3 square by 2. If we come straight below this, the coordinates of that point are same x coordinate because they're in the same vertical line. But it is on the curve, so I have to put it in the curve, which will come x1 plus x2 plus x3 by 3 whole square. This y coordinate is greater than this y coordinate, obviously. Did I write same reverse? I don't want to take it. Okay, so you'll get x1 square plus x2 square plus x3 square by 3 is greater than or equal to x1 plus x2 plus x3 by 3 whole square. So if I cancel 1, 3 and bring the 3 here, that should be greater. So this is a less than, okay. This is less than or equal. Okay. So same things for n. You can write n things here, n here, n here. Cancel 1, n, bring in here, get it. Another method is, some of you studied about variance recently, and somebody studied in some time back maybe. variance has two formulas. One of the formula is, second formula at least, is sigma xi square by n minus mean whole square. Sigma xi by n whole square. This is a variance formula, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Sir. But variance, according to the first definition, it is sigma xi minus mean whole square by n. Something whole square, sum of the squares of many things, their average, it can't be negative. It has to be greater than or equal to zero. If the first definition gives you greater than or equal to zero, the second definition, that is second formula, also should be greater than or equal to zero. Send this one that side, we'll get the same thing. Sigma xi square by n is greater than or equal to sigma xi by n whole square. Cancel, bring one n this side. Yes, that is less than this. Okay. So from the variance formula you can understand, from Jensen inequality you can understand. But there is another way. It may appear a little lengthy, but we can still do it. You really expand this. This also you write x1 square n times, x2 square n times. Okay. When you bring one side, it is possible to write this as, that is this minus this. When you expand fully and bring it, it is possible to write it as sum of many perfect squares. Okay. When you write it as sum of many perfect squares, it has to be greater than or equal to zero. Okay. Right now, I don't have the time to tell, but that is one more method. I'm sure there can be some slight variation of this. Sometimes we tell expectation or mean of square of some quantities is greater than expectation whole square. Okay. Or mean whole square. Okay. So, whatever it is, we proved this. Okay, so now coming to this present question options, I think directly there are these things only. The question they mentioned that let xk be a real number, xk is greater than or equal to k power 4 plus k square plus 1, k is between 1 to 2018, and capital N represent to sum of all the k values. But I think all these things doesn't matter. Look at the second statement here. Okay, this is exactly what I wrote on the board, right? But we don't have x1, x2, x3. We have, instead of x1, they took x1 only. Instead of x2, they took 2x2. Instead of x3, they took 3x3. Instead of xn, they took nxn. Okay. But what about capital N? What is the difference?
Sir, in question they gave 7.
I indicate the capital N, but no. What is the difference between first and second statement? I'm just saying.
Sir, k square, sir, in right expression.
Oh. Okay, right side it is k square. Okay. If it is k square, I have to take it like this, which is less than or equal to n only. I should write small n only, not capital N. I should be able to write x1 square, 2x1 whole square, 3x3 whole square, so on up to nx3 whole square. Then capital N will change. I'll explain statement one and then come back to statement two. Okay. Okay, statement one is based on this, but we are taking quantity x1 only once, quantity x2 we are taking twice, quantity x3 we are taking thrice, and quantity xn we are taking n times also. Then this n is not, how many elements are there? 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4, so on. It is 1 plus 2 plus 3, so on up to n. And this also x1 square only once, x2 square twice, x3 square thrice, and xn square n times. So if you write properly, what is this? sigma k xk whole square. 1 into x1, 2 into x2, 3 into x3, 4 into x4. What is this sum of n natural numbers? That is exactly that capital N. And what is this sigma k into xk square? Square is only for this, because x1 square added once, x2 square added twice, x3 square added thrice, xn square added n times. Okay, so that is statement one. It's quite correct. Where it is like you know, we have weighted arithmetic mean, weighted geometric mean. Many of you don't know. We'll discuss in detail. But basically, we can take one quantity twice, another quantity thrice, or something. When you apply, you will get this. So that is see this part carefully. Sigma k x k means each x k should be added k times. Then here each x k square also should be added k times, and the total number of elements I should consider is not just n elements, 1 plus 2 plus 3, so on up to n. Okay, but statement two, even there is a square for k also. I think still statement two is correct. I'll tell you in what way.
K times x is.
No.
Kx is considered less than u times.
What you are saying?
Yes, sir. Now before you took k, xk is the term, sir. Now you take kxk is the term.
There is a problem with that. N will not come this end. We take x1 as one element, 2x2 together as one element.
Kx has one element, sir.
That's what I'm also saying. 3x3 as one element, nxn as one element. Then the number of elements is n only, na? Okay, but still I'll tell you how to prove it. Okay, anyway, so I want to divide this part here. Okay, or it's okay, not required to write. So I'll take x1 once, 2x2 together only once, 3x2 together only once, nx.
That only.
Yeah, that only. But we'll not get capital N. We'll get small n. And what you get is this square plus this square plus this square, which is x1 square plus 2x2 whole square plus 3x3 whole square, so on up to nxn whole square. That will give you anyway sigma k square xn square. But we are not getting capital N here. But no problem. This is less than this. This is less than what they gave, right?
Yes, sir.
Compared to small n, capital N is bigger. So I can say this is less than or equal to capital N, and this is same. Okay, but only thing is, I think equality will never happen. Okay, because earlier, if you want equality to happen, all these quantities should be equal. That's fine.
Sir, all can be zero, no?
Yes, only in zero case it's okay. But in general, okay, other than zero case, in the previous case when all quantities are equal, it will come. But here, when all quantities are equal, this and this are equal, but not this and this. So this is strictly less than this only, not equal. It can be equal only for one element. So n elements, you take only one. But anyway, how to get that k square x square? I think you understood now. You take, don't take x2 twice. You take 2x2 together as one element, 3x2 together as 3x3 as one element. You will get. Okay, is it clear now? 18th one, statement one and statement two. Or anybody any doubt? So in this place, actually, I'll get small n, but that can be replaced with capital N and increased further. So not
there is no use of the given data.
Yeah, that this data is only just to mislead or unnecessary. X k greater than or equal to k power 4 plus k square plus 1 doesn't have any significance. We are not going to use it anyway. Is it all right? Anybody want time to understand or want to copy or something?
Sir, want time to copy.
Okay. Anytime when I'm going forward, if somebody can stop me, either they want to take time to understand or time to copy, or they want to ask something. Thank you.
completed, sir.
Others can just read 19, try to draw figure, think about it. So whenever meeting ends, okay, so you don't have to rejoin, class will be over, that's it, okay. If we are left something in between, we'll continue in the next class. Okay, so what is this 19th question? We have a parabola. There is a lattice rectum. It has two points of trisection. And an ellipse is like this, where it is passing through these two points of trisection as and so minor x, because they said the focus is the center of the ellipse, I think. And it is passing through this. So for the ellipse, this should be minor axis, this should be major axis, or vice versa, but this is the center, these are the two axes. So depending on this is longer, one of them will happen. BDTEC. B, D, E, C. B, C is a lattice rectum. Center. That's it. Okay. So this is a parabola x square equal to 4ky. This is the lattice rectum, so this should be the focus, which is 0, comma k. So this height is k. This total is 4k. So this is 4k by 3, this is 4k by 3, this is 4k by 3. So this is 2k by 3, this is 2k by 3. Now they want for this ellipse eccentricity. So this is a minor axis and this is a major axis. Eccentricity formula for ellipse is 1 minus b by a whole square. That is 1 minus b is 2k by 3 and a is k. So you can use b by a whole square or a by b whole square, doesn't matter depending on horizontal, vertical, but the point is it is a semi-minor axis by semi-major axis. So that is 1 minus 4 by 9 root over 5 by 9, that's it, root 5 by 3. Okay, so the question is, you take two lattice rectum, find the two points of trisection, and the ellipse center should be on this line only, and ellipse should pass through D and E, and it should pass through this. So based on this, we can understand this is a minor axis, this is a major axis. This is the y coordinate of the focus, which is k, and this is the semi minor axis. Is it okay, 19th one?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I'm going to erase this 90. Okay, coming to 20, before discussing 20, one or two small things about the functions theorems. Everybody knows when f is 1, 1, f a to b, let us say. If f 1, a to b is 1, 1, and g a to b is 1, 1, we know g circle f a to b is 1, 1. But the converse is not true. That is, if G circle F A to B is 1, 1, it is not necessary that both G and F should be 1, 1, but F must be 1, 1. F must be 1. G need not be 1. Similarly, when F is on to and G is on to, we know G circle F is on to. But the converse is not true. That is, when G circle F is on 2, then G must be on 2. F need not be on 2. Okay. If somebody wants, I can give an example. Let us say I'll take X here, G here, this is A, B, C. You take 1, 2, 3. A, B, C, D. Connect like this and leave D here. Take PQR. You can see F is 1, 1, but not onto because D is left. G is onto because everything is used here, but two elements are connected to one element, so it is not 1, 1. But if you take total G circle F from A to C, from the beginning to end, if you see G circle F, 1, 2, 3 are connected to PQR, which is bijection. So because G circle F is 1, 1, here G circle F is 1, 1, but it's not both are 1, 1. F must be 1, 1. G need not be 1. Okay. And because G circle F is on 2, G is on. F need not be on. Okay. So these are some theory. And of course, one another way of saying is, from this I can say F must be 1, 1. And if F is not 1, 1, definitely G circle F also will not be 1. Similarly, if G is not onto, definitely G circle F also will not be onto. Okay. So coming to this present question. They said already in the question, G is 1, 1, injective. And they also said G circle F is on 2, which implies G is on 2. Okay. So G is 1, 1 mentioned directly, G is on 2 is mentioned indirectly. So G is a bijection. Now they're asking about F, whether it must be 1, 1 or not, it must be on 2 or not. So we have to carefully see. F is from 0 to 1, closed interval minus 1 to 1. G is from minus 1 to 1 to closed interval 0 to 2. And G circle F is from 0 to 1 to 0 to 2. Okay. So G is 1, 1 mentioned in the question. Because G circle F is on 2 mentioned in the question, we are able to conclude G is on 2. Regarding F, let's say what is happening here actually. this is f, this is g, this is 0 to 1, this is minus 1 to 1, this is 0 to 2. So there's a lot of elements here we are connecting and all that. What happens is G circle F, everything has to be used here. Okay. And what is G? Minus 1 to 1. All elements are connected to this 0 to 2. Okay. G is a bisection. Please remember it is both 1, 1 and on 2. Now, what is the problem? If F is not on 2, what will happen? Let's say all these elements from 0 to 1 are connected to few elements only. I left with few elements here. Okay. Then in G circle F, those elements will not come, because if these elements are not used in the F's codomain, that is in the range of F, then in G circle F, these images will be missing. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So F has to be on 2. Okay. But F need not be 1, 1. Why? For example, between 0 to half only, I'll connect all the elements to this. Between 1 by 2 to half also, I'll connect all the elements here. Not a problem. My F's range will cover this whole thing, and they will be connected to this whole thing. So G circle F, everything will cover. Okay. So with all these conditions,